I'm at Riverbanks Zoo and Gardens in Columbia, South Carolina, speaking with my friend Susan Boyd. Susan, we are here today celebrating another accomplishment of the Darnall and Susan Boyd Foundation, which is the refurbishment of the Reptile and Aquatic Center at the zoo. And honestly, I think it's just fascinating because these are things that people see less and less frequently now. You're making it possible for people to be up close and personal with things and to develop an appreciation of their importance in the natural world.
Well, it is wonderful. And I have to say it, the reptiles and snakes and things are special. There's so much disappearing and so important to have them stay with us.
Susan, I look forward to coming back and visiting with you more frequently. We've been to Boyd Island, and now we're going to have more things that y'all involved in. Susan, thank y'all for everything that y'all have done.
Oh, thank you so much. Think of the fun we had doing it.
Yes.
Yeah, it was great. And I'm so glad to be here.
I'm speaking with Sean Foley, and Sean, you are the resident herpetology specialist at Riverbanks Zoo and Garden. Tell us what herpetology involves.
So herpetology is basically the study of reptiles and amphibians.
Okay, and we sure have plenty of those in South Carolina.
We absolutely do. We have got a great abundance of reptiles and amphibians for people to see.
And when we first walk in, I think you highlight the ones that are from South Carolina.
Correct. When you first walk into our building, you're going to see these floor-to-ceiling exhibits, really large, with multiple species in most of those exhibits. And they are native to South Carolina, except for a big alligator snapping turtle. He is native to the southeastern United States, but not specifically to South Carolina. But you'll see pine snakes, you'll see eastern diamondback rattlesnakes, you'll see canebrake rattlesnakes, eastern glass lizards. All those are in one exhibit. It's a really interesting exhibit. You have lots of different species in there moving around, so and they all get along, and it's a really neat exhibit.
And then what else do you have in that?
So then if you go to the next exhibit, you'll see timber rattlesnakes.
Uh-huh.
You will see copperheads, our most common venomous snake that most people see those in their lifetimes. And then corn snakes, really pretty bright orange corn snakes.
Y'all have a special one?
The color morph is Okatee from Jasper County. So they're bright pumpkin orange, have that black contrast. So they're really, really pretty. And then when you go to the next exhibit, you'll see the alligator snapping turtle. It's the largest freshwater turtle in North America. They can get up to 250 pounds. So a really impressive turtle. And then you go to the last exhibit and you're going to see eastern cottonmouths.
Uh-huh.
So that's another one of our venomous snakes that people can see.
But then you've got some other wonderful exhibits, so let's continue our tour.
So if you go to the right, the tropical forest area.
Yes.
Used to be our desert gallery, is now tropical forest. And so we transformed that from desert to tropical exhibits. And you'll see different tree monitors. Those are from Indonesia, that area. A lot of them are found on specific islands.
Oh.
So like black tree monitors, you'll find those from Aru Islands. The green tree monitors will be from mainland Indonesia. Blue tree monitors are from their own specific little islands. So it's really kind of cool. And then you'll see in the center of that, you'll see Bushmasters, which is the largest pit viper in the Americas. They get almost 10 feet long.
Gracious.
And then those are in with emerald tree boas. So up high, you'll have emerald tree boas, down low, the bushmasters, and there's colorful frogs that you'll see hopping around there. So that's another really cool multi-species exhibit.
Well, let's continue going on around.
Okay, so once you get through that tropical forest, you're gonna end up in the desert biome.
Ooh.
And that used to be our tropical habitat, the Cayman Island blue iguanas. We still have those. The Galapagos tortoises,
yes.
The juveniles, you probably saw those.
Yes.
We have those in there. But then we got some new species. So we have some spiny-tailed agamids, which is a small lizard from Africa. They're new species for us. Some of the desert rattlesnakes, we did not have that before. So we have western diamondbacks, Mojave rattlesnakes, rock rattlesnakes, all these rattlesnakes. There's about 10 rattlesnakes in this big exhibit. It's really cool. So then once you go through there, you'll get to our old tropical gallery, which we're calling Land to Sea, and that's transitioning into the whole aquarium area.
Y'all have a special animal that you are have really learned a lot about, and y'all raise those here and share them with other zoos, so let's talk about that.
So you'll get through all the aquarium area, and the last thing you'll see is the biodiversity wall. And there's 15 small exhibits in this wall. A lot of them have leaf-tailed geckos, and those are native to Madagascar. And that's one of our specialties that we've been doing for about 30 years now. And we breed them here at Riverbanks. We run the programs for those. So we send those animals to zoos all over the country and actually all over the world. We actually sent 60 of them to the Chester Zoo over in England several years ago. And then they sent those to other zoos over there. So we're trying to get those all over the world.
I think one of the things that happens here, I hope, and I'm sure it does because of the skill that y'all have in presenting these, is that you're getting people excited about these and letting people think these are things that we should care about and want to protect their environment.
Oh, absolutely. We try to make that connection so they can see these animals. They can see the graphics that we have that explains what's going on. We can explain what's going on with their habitats, because it's not just in South Carolina where their animals are losing habitat. It's everywhere around the world. Tropical rainforests are disappearing. So these animals face a lot of challenges, and we want people to be able to see these animals in naturalistic environments and just to make that connection that yes, these animals, you can see how beautiful they are, how an integral part of their community they are in their environments. And hopefully they can take that and just, you know, go out into the world and be good stewards of our environment.
I've had a wonderful time learning all about these things, some of which we kept as children in our home. And now I'm gonna go over and learn about the aquarium.
Sounds good.
Talking to Kendra Bottini, who's the curator of the aquarium at Riverbanks Zoo and Botanical Gardens. And I think you've been here about as long as the Galapagos turtles.
I'm in my 17th year, so not quite.
but it's fascinating because you've been here to see so many changes. And of course, with the wonderful gift from the Boyd Foundation, Darnall and Susan Boyd, y'all were able to make dramatic changes and add so much diversity and educational material to the aquarium, I believe.
Yes, the donation that the foundation gave was really wonderful. We've really gotten to be able to showcase some of these amazing things that zoos and aquariums are doing, the biodiversity that the oceans have to offer. It's very exciting for our visitors to be able to see some of that new stuff that we have here.
It is stunningly beautiful too. Gosh, mm-hmm. Pete, the displays are beautiful. Y'all should be commended on your artistic talents as well as keeping some of these animals alive because they can be a bit finicky. But let's do talk about, I'm gonna call her Mrs. Boyd, mm-hmm. The new octopus that you have.
Yes, so Susan is a giant Pacific octopus, and we've been having her for a few months now, and we've started to learn her personality. She's very inquisitive and is always trying to decide what you're doing in her home now. So
tell me about her taking the cleaning brush away.
Yes. The one day I was actually up there with a very long scrub brush and I was scrubbing in the tank. And something that's interesting about giant Pacific octopus is they tend to know who their person is.
Oh.
And I am not her primary person.
Uh-huh.
I was taking care of her for that keeper that day. She was off doing something. And so I was up there doing a little bit of work and immediately she just grabbed onto that scrub brush and I tried to pull it back and there was no way that she was giving this up. And so then I just left it with her and shut the doors, and because they're very curious and escape artists. So we have very special doors.
Yes.
Up there that will keep her in. And so I shut the doors and I walked away and set a timer and kept going back like every 15 to 20 minutes, and she had that brush for 3 hours. And she finally let it go.
And she's really just a huge mass of muscle, I believe. Is that true?
Yes. They are very, very strong. The only hard part on their body is their beak. And they have, you know, the beak, and they have all those suckers and the 8 arms, pretty large bulbous head. The very interesting ability to change colors and change their body texture. They can change their skin texture they do it to blend in, but I feel they also do it to show emotions that they're having. So yeah, it's very interesting to watch them.
I've read that, I don't know how they gave them a comparative test, but they were almost as smart as a cat.
I could believe that, yes.
Yeah. It's just stunning. And the octopus have a rather fascinating life story. Mm-hmm. And so they come from a teeny, teeny, tiny egg that hatches into a teeny, tiny baby octopus?
Yes, and they grow relatively quickly. Uh-huh. Because they do have a short lifespan. So actually, they're growing at about 3% sometimes of their body weight a day.
Gracious goodness.
So we do weigh her regularly and adjust her diet accordingly. So their exhibit time is very short, actually. It's probably a year to a year and a half, really. So yes, the female octopus will lay her eggs and guard them, and then shortly thereafter she usually passes. So it's a short-lived but very full life that they live.
And they're not endangered, and so it will be easy to replace her. You're not harming the species or anything.
No, I mean, most marine animals, obviously, they have their concerns between climate change and overfishing, and they do lay a lot of eggs and they do reproduce a lot, and they're relatively common along that the western coastline and up into Alaska.
Okay. Well, I'm sure that it sounds like from everything y'all are doing, Susan is going to have a very, very, very happy life here.
Yes, she will have a full life. She gets lots of enrichment.
And then these moon jellyfish, what a funny looking animal.
Yeah.
And you said they really just kind of use currents to float around.
Yes, they have the ability to pulse and to swim a little bit, but for the most part, these are animals that are living in the open ocean, and they're just at the mercy of the currents and kind of just float along and eat plankton. And they are a food source for other animals, so they're just filling that part of the food chain.
I believe that y'all feed them individually, something crazy like that.
So our exhibit, which is pretty large,
it's big.
We do individually feed the moon jellies in there with a turkey baster, and they're eating brine shrimp. In the backup space, we do culture them because they are also a short-lived animal. And so we need to culture them to be able to keep them sustainable within our zoo. And so we usually are broadcasting those because there's so many jellies back there.
Okay.
So.
And then just a huge, wonderful, fascinating array of, I think, mostly things that are from colder waters. Is that correct? It's just stunning, the things you have. Talk about some of your favorites.
Yeah, so in the same gallery as Susan the Octopus, we have a wide array of cold water marine animals. And so most of these are gonna come from that western coastline of the United States. And there is one exhibit that is Southern Australia. So that's gonna be our potbelly seahorses and our ornate cowfish that are from Australia. And they're very, very fun to watch.
And which is the one that sticks out of the sand a little bit, that crazy?
That's in our coral reef area, and that's called a garden eel. They're very fun.
That's a very strange little animal.
Yeah, their faces look like Muppets, I think.
And y'all are involved in a national project. You were selected to do this. Tell me about coral reefs, and we know that their importance in protecting coastlines and things like that, but I think there's been a disease that's been harming them.
Right. So on the Florida Reef Tract, which is in mid-Florida down through the Keys, there's something called stony coral tissue loss disease, which they're not 100% sure what exactly is causing it. But what happened was in 2018, we came onto the project, and there are about 20 other zoos and aquariums that are involved now throughout the United States. And we're acting as external nurseries for these corals.
So hoping that they can be reintroduced if and when it would be safe to do so?
Yes, a reintroduction, there will be some breeding and spawning, and then reintroduction of the offspring.
And coral is actually an animal.
Yes.
Is that correct?
It is.
And they have a symbiotic relationship with something that gives them their color. Tell me a little bit about this crazy stuff going on.
So coral is an animal, but it's also has symbiotic algae called zooxanthellae. And that is going to be photosynthesizing. It's also what gives coral its vibrant and different colors. So different strains of zooxanthellae are going to show different colorations. So not only is the coral getting the nutrients from the algae, but also it's getting nutrients from plankton that's floating along, because most coral is also going to be eating. So they have feeder tentacles that go out, they have little mouths, and each polyp is going to be able to take in food.
It's a strange looking animal.
It's very cool though. They're all different. They're all different colors and shapes, and they're beautiful things.
And you do have an exhibit that is things that would be from our ocean, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so we have a large Atlantic tank, and then we also have a mangrove exhibit. And both of those are showcasing a lot of animals that you'd see more tropical, prettier things that you'd see in Florida and the Caribbean. But there are also some animals that are in there that you would find on our coastline, like spade fish and look downs, burrfish, some triggerfish. And then also that Atlantic tank will be the home for our sea turtle.
Oh.
So we have a partnership with South Carolina Department of Natural Resources, where we head start a sea turtle, a green sea turtle, and every 2 years we release one. So right now our sea turtle is not on exhibit because it's too small,
mm-hmm.
But here in a few months it'll be on exhibit in that large Atlantic tank.
I think when we listen to the things you've said about what y'all are doing, we realize that a zoo is not an observation site primarily,
mm-hmm.
But along with that, equally important is conservation and raising awareness of some of the ecological threats that we're facing.
Yes, and near and dear to my heart is helping the state of South Carolina and our southeastern area. So I'm really excited to be able to help with the Sea Turtle Project. I'm really excited for the coral reef work that we do with the state of Florida. I think it's all very important stuff to be able to really hit home. You know, this is what we have here on our soil, and this is why it's important.
Kendra, I think it's wonderful that the Darnall and Susan F. Boyd Foundation selected this as one of the projects that they're supporting. It's just a tremendous educational opportunity and a conservation opportunity for South Carolina. It's a wonderful venue to come to.
Oh, thank you for coming and seeing us today, Amanda, and we're happy to show you around and showcase this new aquarium and reptile conservation center.